This is mainly my PhD project, so we will present a very general view of this project because there's a lot of things inside, so maybe we can be here like for 5 hours talking, so we try to make our best.
Okay, this is just a quick overview. I'm just going to actually go back for a second. And so what we're going to talk about today is sort of give you a general overview of sort of the archaeological reasons we're going to be using some of the analytical approaches that we're discussing today in the context of this sort of very vast landscape, sort of littered with gares here and there. And so we're just going to go over the archaeology very, very quickly in the project, and then run through some of the methods and talk about our current and future work. I just want to give you a very, very brief overview of sort of the big issue of pastoralist archaeology. So we have the steppe, which is this big, vast area that's covering all the way from Ukraine all the way over to all the way out through Mongolia. And there's been it's been in sort of the archaeological news a lot recently. There was a big paper that came out last year doing ancient DNA of Bronze Age skeletal remains from up in Russia and parts of Kazakhstan as well, arguing that the spread of pastoral nomadism had to do with these big population movements. And this is actually sort of very much sort of confirming sort of very old school cultural history models where you have large-scale migrations are being responsible for some of these processes that we're seeing in the steppe. The sort of sampling issues with this study aside, keeping in mind that this is only based off of 200 individuals, it doesn't actually capture a lot of the nuance of these processes. We actually know very, very little about the spread of pastoral nomadism in the steppe. We know almost nothing. And why do we care? Pastoralism in the steppe is sort of, it's very, very different from what you get, say, out in the Near East. So when we think of in prehistory about 10,000 years ago, what we have are, in the Near East, it was a center of domestication for animals. So we have your sheep, your goats, and your cattle, and also pigs. Of course, pigs don't go very far. And when you have your first push out of pastoralists out in, say, from that Near Eastern core, they take with them plants as well. And the situation in the central Eurasian steppe is actually a bit different. It's a very tessellated process where we have pastoralists moving out only with their animals. We have pastoralists moving out with animals and with plants, and also still exploiting wild resources quite heavily, including like fish and also wild plants. Wrong way. This map sort of reflects this situation. This is a very intentionally sketchy map. You'll notice there are no dates on it. There's just a bunch of wiggly arrows and some mysterious circles on it, okay? This is very intentional, actually. This reflects very much what we don't know. What these arrows are supposed to be representing are potential sort of pathways for the spread of animal domesticates and also plant cultivars into the region. So you've got everything that's going on in Europe, okay? So remember in Europe at this time around, we're looking at around 3,000 or so, 3,000 BC. You've got the full sort of Neolithic package. You've got wheat and barley and sheep and goats and pigs and all these things. You've got that there. Then you have what's going on in Anatolia, the Iranian plateau. You have your sheep, your goats, your cattle, and also pigs there. But of course, again, the pigs don't tend to go very far. And you have all of these potential routes going throughout Central Asia. And then of course, you have also these animals are also in China, okay? Now, keeping in mind that those animals were not domesticated in China, they are also Near Eastern domesticates, but they made their way to China actually quite early. So we have all these potential modes of entry into the steppe, but we haven't really figured out much of anything at all, because there's relatively few sites, and what people tend to focus on is stuff like this. Oh, wrong way. Like this, okay? So when you think of steppe archaeology, you think of this. Monuments, deer stones, all kinds of things like that. But pastoralist occupation sites are very ephemeral in general. That's sort of the idea. They're moving around a lot, and they're not leaving lots of stuff behind. Well, first of all, that's not entirely true, is that pastoralists, they tend to, they often, not always, they may visit sites over and over again. So that causes an accumulation of materials that we're interested in. And they're also sort of using the landscape in lots of different ways that have actually nothing to do with these monuments. maybe I'm going to turn this around and that will help. Yeah, there we go. There. So when we're thinking about pastoral nomadic mobility, and again, we're thinking also going back to that crazy map with all the arrows on it, how are these people actually moving across the landscape and how are they engaging with it? And of course, they're concerned about their resources. They're concerned about the distribution of graze for their animals, the quality of that graze, and how it's actually being, how that graze is actually renewed over throughout the seasons. There's actually also pastoralist infrastructure, that sort of image of pastoral nomads wandering across the steppe with sort of nothing but their gear and maybe a camel. That's not really true at all. Is that pastoralists invest in that landscape. They build winter camps, they build like cisterns to collect water, and they're actually modifying sometimes even the actual pastures themselves by burning land and even enhancing the growth of graze there. Of course, your social relationships are very important when you are structuring your movement. You don't just go out into the big nothing and say, I'm just gonna go and see what happens. Who is there, who's not there, can also inform your mobility decisions, how far you go and where you're gonna go on that landscape. We do get back to those monuments in the archaeological record, is that those monuments are actually places on the landscape that bring people together. There are these big ceremonial activities that are going on that are actually they're these charismatic sort of events, and they draw people in over time, year after year, for short or even extended durations. And of course, when we think of this step also, is you have to think about political authority. Is a lot of these pastoral nomadic groups, even starting way back in around 2000 calibrated BC, is that you actually start having the formation of these trans-egalitarian societies, and that eventually actually evolve into larger political confederacies who are actually structuring pastoralist movement as well. So what I'm basically saying is that pastoralists aren't sort of wandering across the landscape sort of willy-nilly, that their decisions are being informed by their resource availability, by their social relationships, and also the political structure of the landscape. So this slide is intentionally blank. I don't know if we can turn this light on for a second. We can. This is my sophisticated slide that I have drawn here. So one of the things that when Natalia and I started thinking about this is how do we get, we've got different scales of landscape use, okay? So we have the landscape and all the resources and social relationships and political complexity sort of slammed on top of that. But then we have smaller scale activities as well, okay? So like the pastoralist campsite. So if this crazy box here, this is W is for winter, S is for summer. We have the distribution of again, wintertime resources, summertime resources, again, including social relationships and also how your political world is structured. But then you have also the camps that these pastoralists live at. The question is, how do we get the data from these different kinds of, from the landscapes and from these sites that talk to each other? Because they're very different kinds of data sets. We've been talking about here in the context of this workshop of these very, very, very detailed, sort of micro level, exciting kind of work to get at some of the site formation processes and cooking and processing and all these kinds of things. But then we have landscape use, all right? And so the challenge is how do we talk about landscape use and mobility and also sites, how sites are being used and also how the mobility even within sites is being structured. How do we get those data sets to actually talk to each other? So the work that Natalia and I are doing with each other, let's see, get the right one here. Nope. Right. So this is where ethnoarchaeology sort of comes into this. So we can use ethnoarchaeology as sort of a way to help bridge these two scales of analyses. And this is just us out in Mongolia. Someone's making sausage, or blood sausage. It was an interesting afternoon. And so my work is really focused on looking at these broader landscape use issues, okay, in the big boxes here. And the way I do that is I'm using stable isotope analysis to do that. So in the ethno-archaeological context, what I've done is I've gone out and I've interviewed herders and I talked to them about how they use the landscape. How are they moving on a seasonal basis? What's informing those decisions and so on and so forth. And just by way of example, one very important factor that influences pastoralist mobility is, of course, the availability of graze. Now, graze availability during the winter season is not very high, right? So it's very cold, there's not any grass left out in the pastures. So what pastoralists have to do is they have to fodder their animals during the wintertime. They actually have to collect graze during the summer, store it, and then go back to that place over and over again. So it's structuring their mobility. So I talked to quite a few herders about this activity. And I did basically a case study, a pilot study, if you will, and that's one of the sort of the important things that we've been discussing here is being able to demonstrate sort of a proof of concept that the approaches that you're using can actually, you can actually know what's going into that system, so when you look at the archaeological case study, you can make sort of very good, you can have a very good understanding of what's going in that particular system. So here we are back in Mongolia, and one of the things that I did there is looking at this issue of foddering, and just some basic quick facts is that this area is a C3, C4 Iranoterranean zone. So C3 plants have a isotope delta C13 value of minus 26, and C4 plants have a value of minus 12. The other important thing you should know is that it's a very seasonal landscape, as I just mentioned. What that means is during the summertime you have C3 and C4 on the landscape, but during the wintertime you only have C3. Okay. The other cool thing that we have there is also we have wild sheep and goats as well as we our domesticates as well. So I interviewed herders. I got samples from their animals with known life histories, so where they went and what they were eating, and then I had a control group of wild animals that were just sort of grazing freely on the landscape. One of the approaches that we're using is this sequential sampling of teeth, and what this gives you is actually these really nice seasonal scale records of dietary intake and also of mobility, and which is really sort of fantastic because we can really start drilling down into what individual animals are doing as reflected by the decisions of their herders. So what this is just showing you very briefly is those big circles there, they're your domesticates, and the X's are your wild animals. And what this is showing is that the domesticated animals have higher delta C13 values than their wild counterparts. This is a direct reflection of foddering, okay? So what's happening is those herders are taking that C3, C4 vegetation, and they're collecting it, and then they feed it to the animals during the wintertime. So basically what's happening is that domesticated animals are receiving a summertime diet almost year-round, whereas your poor wild animals are accessing only that C3 sort of crappy graze during the wintertime. This is just sort of that same data, just sort of looking again at that sequential analysis. If you just pay attention to the red ones, you can ignore the black dots for a second. As you can see, again, the seasonal shift in that. What we have here is when those red, the values in the reds, the delta C13 values, when they start going up, that's actually the winter time. So you can see when those animals start accessing that fodder and they start coming off of it. And there's some variation in there. That variation is actually very important because those reflect herders' decisions, okay? Because if you have 100 animals and you only have one big pile of fodder, that's not gonna last you the whole year. So you have to make decisions. You have to say, my female animals, which are the most important for producing milk, for producing progeny, and so on and so forth, those are the ones that have to survive. The guys, the male animals, well, they're kind of expendable, okay? So that variation in there, it is from those decisions. So that's pretty pretty neat stuff. The other thing that we can look at using this kind of sequential data is also mobility. Now mobility is being structured by, again, graze availability, foddering, and so on and so forth. And again, we can start breaking it apart. So in Mongolia, for example, is that different animals are herded in different ways. So you don't actually keep all your animals in one, you know, you don't keep your sheep and your goats and your horses all together. You put them in different directions because they have different feeding requirements, also water requirements as well. So what happens is these animals get spread out into the landscape, and they each have their own individual mobility histories as well. And pastoralists are always trying to figure out the best grazing solutions for their animals. I'm not going to go into the gory details of this particular slide, but if you want to take a look at the bottom there where it says strontium, again, these are animals with known life histories, and we can see that they're actually accessing different portions of the landscape in different ways. And that's reflecting, again, where the herders are actually putting their animals. So we're getting this, starting to get this picture of how modern pastoralists are using their landscape and how we can actually see that in the isotopic record. Now, that's great stuff. I'm personally like very excited about that because it's, you know, when we're thinking about this in an archaeological perspective, we understand the isotopic systems that are actually producing the results that we're seeing, and then we can start extrapolating, we can make grand statements about political formation and so on and so forth. The thing that this is not telling us, however, is how are pastoralists using these smaller spaces, these boxes here, the sites and the areas around, directly around where they're living. And this is really key. And it's not something that we can actually capture with this city-stable isotopic data. And this is where some of the work that Natalia is doing comes into play.
So for me, I'm trying to track the dung record in this little campsites. As Cheryl said, it's very important to know how the function of these campsites are doing in the landscape and how they are keeping the animals inside, because as we will see, it's not the one way to keep the animals. So every family does in different ways, and every region, we can say, does it also in a different way because they have different resources. So for us, many of you would know, dung is super important because they have a lot of information inside. We can see these micro remains of dung into the soil, not only in the pellets in the surface, like we see it here. Like this is cattle dung, it's a pile of cattle dung. This is the ovicaprin pellets and even dog coprolite. But when these things disintegrate into the soil, you can see the microstructure into the soil. So with micromorphology, we can distinguish if it's cattle or if it's an ovicaprin dung inside of the soil. So even carnivores like dog or other species. So, and this is when you have an archaeological site, it's sometimes very difficult to track in the surface because you don't see it. But doing the micromorphology or organic chemistry, we can detect these things in the soil. So that's why the project is trying to couple everything together, like starting from the ethnography, doing part of geosciences with some techniques like micromorphology or some FTIR, and then going to the biosciences with the stable isotopes and then lipid biomarkers for achieving information that can be useful for the archaeological record. So that's why the importance of ethnography in this case. So I will start what we did and present these winter campsites. So this is Mongolia, right? Everyone that thinks of Mongolia see imagine in their mind. This is a flat landscape with these wavy hills, grass everywhere, but it's not really true because this is the image that the movies show us. By the way, these are very good movies. You can see them. But it's always like this perfect landscape that everything is so neat there, like a green, everything is everywhere is happy, and there's a lot of animals, some herders randomly moving in there with the animals, but this is not the real image. That's why, we have again this variability. We have it in the landscape, and we have this variability also affecting the herders and the way they behave, because it is not like to be like deterministic approach, but because we have a lot of other things, not only climate, but we have different herd animals, we have interaction with predators, that is very important, also some areas of the steppe. The weather seasonality, natural fires that are affecting also the forest and the steppe, the resources availability like wood and water, and then the human cultural practice. Mongolians are very traditional society, so they usually do what their grandfather did in the past, so they keep doing it now today. So again, we wanted to point out this variability is important when we try to study this society. So what we did is we went to the Eastern Mongolia, and we made a transit from the north going to the south, because here is the Eurasian steppe, and there are some transitional zones. This is very the ideal steppe zone, and then we have the transition into the Gobi, and you will see these three areas are very different. So we're trying to get them to detect. Smooth everything. We're trying to detect these three ecoregions variability into the stable, the little campsites. So we've sampled 56 campsites. Most of them are winter campsites, and some were like spring, but like six of these 56 were spring pastoral campsites. And they usually have, the herds are very big. So the medium size of our herd for one family is like 600 animals, but even they can have more than 1,000. And they have a horse, a cattle, a sheep, and goat, and camels, but you will see camels that are only used for transport, and they're fewer and fewer all the time. So we collect 1 ton of samples, between bones, soil, sediment, pellets, coprolites from the dogs also, plants and water. So we'll start with the winter campsites. So this is the north. You see there's a very good forest cover here. So they built a very, very super big structures. Like they made like this little stables for sheep and goat. Then in the other side, they made the big areas that are not covered for horses and also for cattle. And then they build these walls, and in between they collect the dung. They will use this dung also for fuel, but I will show you that later. And, sorry.
And just to sort of bring this bit together, some of these different data sets, is that what's neat about these winter pastures is these winter camps, it's the pasture that's in front of them that's important. So on top of the foddering, they also have these reserved areas to put their animals during the winter time. So they don't graze there in the summer, they absolutely reserve that. And they're fixed landscape resources on the landscape. So obviously they're investing in building these ginormous winter camps. I mean, really serious stuff, as you just saw. And they graze their animals there year in and year out. And those animals are continually pooping on that graze year in and year out. And so, because of that, what's happening is they're actually fertilizing the soil. And you can see that actually in the isotopic record of the teeth of these animals. And all this is showing here, again, these are winter forming teeth. And as those animals are getting put onto these pastures, which are enriched in 15N, is that their delta N15 values go up and up and up. And you can see here, like the black ones, for example, those are going up fairly nicely. All right, and then you've got others again that there's not much happening there on the left side there. Again, that's due to variation in herder decisions. You put your females first, you give the females first the fodder, then you give them the winter pasture. And so that's what we see here. And the two individuals where those delta N15 values are going up, those are female animals. And the ones where they're not really doing much of anything, they're male animals, okay? So again, we're trying to get at different scales. So what we can see using the stable isotopic approach, we can say, these animals were put on winter pastures and they were in winter camps, but we don't know how they were managed further with some of the stuff that Natalia's doing. She can open up and actually we can look at that kind of management at a very different scale.
So this was one of the first winter campsites that we found. We were doing, like Sherry said, some interviews, so the families told us, we have the winter camp in that direction, like just 50 kilometers away. So we went there and that was the way we did it. We were asking the people where they have these winter campsites, because they go back every year to the same spots. They only change the spot if there is a natural wildfire occurring. They destroy the campsite and then they they go out to find new pastures. But usually, if like these campsites, they are being in use more than 50 years. So like three generations of the family are using the same spots all the time. So this is a very big, one of the biggest that we found. As you can see here, this is the people. Like, this is us inside of the campsite. So it gives you the scale of this magnificent campsite. And this guy, of the head of the family, he was having 1,200 animals. So if you think about putting in the winter, he has to protect them from also from predators and protect it from the cold, because it's very cold, as Sverre said. It's like, in this region can be like minus 20, minus 30 degrees. So they have a very, very smart structure. In some enclosures, they only put the females that can give birth. In other enclosures, they only put the males that are young. In others, they only put the females that cannot give birth anymore, and so on. So as you see here inside of the campsite, you don't see it from the outside. They have also special enclosures for keeping the baby animals warm and protected from the cold. And this, in the north, is a very typical winter campsite, because they have this palisade here of the, you see that the wood is like forming some intersections, and very tall, because they said that the wolves can jump into the enclosure. So, and they usually have like two or three attacks losing some goats during the winter. So they use dung to also reinforce all these structures. They put the dung into the top of the covers, they put it inside of this palisade, they put it to reinforce the floor, also inside of these little cages that are dung, the dung, and then fodder, and then again dung, so they keep it warm. And you see here more in detail, this is the dung, cattle dung, they use the cattle dung for doing this, and also in the cover. So this is what Sherry was talking about, this is the foddering campsites. So they collect them, and they were, there you can see they are scattering all over the landscape, so they belong to different families, and they just collect, and they keep the fodder there, and they're have this resource for giving to the animals in winter. So this is another campsite of winter campsite. You see there's no structure, no walls. So this is we asked the people, the family, and said, no, we don't use it many times because we have another better spot. But you can see this is all dung, these circular things. So this is our, actually, they didn't keep the wood in here, because they usually, when they move to another campsite, the wood is so a precious resource for them, they move it with the wood. They dismantle the campsite and they move with the wood. You can see it here, another time, another campsite here, these little dung spots.
Can I just add something, Natalia? And Natalia's mentioned this, but just to emphasize, look at the variation already in the types of winter campsites. So we have like these big ginormous sites with lots of infrastructure. And then we have sort of ones like this that are just sort of a spot. It's a protected spot. Okay, and that's important. It's really important. And this is like another kind. And you've got this incredible variation in these types of sites. It's slightly regional. Up north where you have lots of trees, you use trees to build these things. And down in the south, you don't have that. So there's a bit of a resource constraint. But the point is that if we're thinking about this as archaeologists, you've got all this kind of variation, and you know, you have different campsites being used by the same family, like the one that you show, where they have a big, ginormous wooden campsite, but they also have sort of this spot on the side of a hill as well.
But anyway, all of them are protected, like Cheryl is saying. This is in the south, so you they put the head in south, because in winter, the 90% of the time, the winds come from northwest. So they are all protected inside of these camps. And this is a satellite image from the Google Earth, so you can distinguish here. Here is a, you see these black spots? This is a dung seen from the space. So this is one campsite, this is another one, this is another one, this is another one. and here's another one. So the wind is coming from here and from here, and all the campsites are protected by these hills in here. So they really care about the animals, and they do smart things. So they are not like randomly spreading in the landscape. So they need to survive in that condition. So this is another type of winter campsite. So we see campsites made with wood, made with rocks, made with anything, because they move the wood. And then we have these walls made with dung. This is a cake, the typical cake, cattle dung. So they accumulate this usually in these months here. You see the pile? So they collect the dung and they put it here to dry, and then they build the walls. And if you think about, they said, maybe they are lying, but everyone was upset when we were asking, how many animals do you keep inside of this enclosure? And they say 800 animals during the whole winter, because they keep warm between each other and they don't want to lose energy moving. So they have to be very, very close to each other so they don't move and they don't lose energy or warm. So it's difficult for us to imagine that in this thing there are 800 animals, but that's what they say. And then this is another type, also in the middle step area. This is a concrete wall. So they had to bring this material from somewhere, and they built this this campsite that we found is a very good sign up here. It's made in 1976. So we know.
And this is just, and this is going back even way back to my, one of my originals has it, like what influences pastoralist mobility about political infrastructure. And this is all Soviet period investment. So it's a collectivization period. And so there was a decision made that if you're building a dung campsite, it's not good enough, and this is better. And so there was some investment in that sense.
So then we go to the south when the Gobi starts, and it's not a sand desert. It's a cold desert and it's very rocky. So what is a natural resource there? There's not forest cover, so they use the stones of the rocky landscape. So they build these walls, and they keep, they have the little ones, they have also the same structures, like little one enclosures for the baby animals, and then the big ones for the other big animals, and then they have the circular ones also made with the stones. So the way they herd their thing is similar, but they use what they have in near. So this is the trace that Agar, the Mongolian tent, lives. So for the archaeological record, it's important to know that we can even try to detect this. All the girls have the same disposition. The doors are always facing south, the ovens and the stoves are always in the right part of the gear. The altars for Buddhist religious rites are always in the front, and the people always sleeps in the left. So trying to do some micromorphology on these little spaces inside of the gear, I think will be also interesting. But now we don't have time, but I think also is this human occupation, that anthropic activity itself is detectable. So this is another trace of another gear. So you see the door was here, and then the stove was here. And then some of them, they use also some stones to protect the floor of the gear. And this is another example of another winter campsite in the Gobi Desert. So they bring the wood from very far away, and they leave this structure there. If you think of all this brown cover, everything is dung. So we can detect this when we go into the micro record. We think everything, the organic material, is going to be preserved very well underneath this. Mm-hmm. You see also the same different enclosures inside the winter campsite for the animals, that when the big animals, they put it out, and the little ones, they put it in. And this is another type, more bigger than the other, with also with the rocks. So you see also the different features. What we did is try to get samples from soil and sediment and pellets of coprolites and blocks of micromorphology for each feature. And then we want to compare what the signals look like in this enclosure and this enclosure, in this enclosure. like this. Like here we have another one, another one. So we sample everything because we want to have like a general view of these campsites. And also use of dung in the Gobi area. They use, because they use, if they don't have cattle dung, they use even the pellets of the goats to reinforce these walls. So we can say the main resource, natural resource they can achieve is the dung, because it's there, it's everywhere. They can take profit of this dung for, like you see, this is, everything is dung. And this is for comparing with this winter campsite, a spring campsite. We won't enter in that because it would be very long to discuss and show all the spring campsites variations, but this is one type just to show you. In winter, in the spring or summer, they just have one little like room, even the gear will be like here. And then they enclosure the animals here, but only for the milking processes, because in, like Sherry said, in spring and in summer, they keep the animals inside during half of the day and for the processes of the animals. So where is the fire? All that we show, it's not like really you can see fire in the record, right? So fire is here. If you see here, we have a dung pile, and then an old enclosure, here another old enclosure, and then here we have the trash pit. Mongolians, they usually only make fire in open air to burn when they leave the campsite. So they don't make, usually they don't make open air fires. And if they make it, they're using stoves. So the only way to track fire, like anthropic fire here, is to track the trash pits of the dump. Because when they leave, they use, they burn this, but the fuel they use is not wood and it's not dung. It's, the gasoline. So this is another trash pit. You see everything like vodka bottles and ash, a mandible, like everything. They throw everything to the same spot, and then when they leave, they just light fire. And they have to stay there to stop the fire. So they cannot leave the fire open and just go away, because the step is so delicate. If something, some spark spreads, you can have a natural fire in there. So it's very well protected. So,
Natalia, can I just make a quick point? And I just want to make a quick point about sort of the dynamism of sort of, you know, the contemporary ethnographic record. We have to remember that, is that, you know, we've heard the word analogy thrown around a lot here, but this fire situation, this is a new thing, right? Because even when I first started working in Mongolia, you didn't see lots of fire pits because there wasn't much trash. Your trash was the bones and you just chuck them out. But you can see in this here, you can see all the plastic and everything. And of course, when you're on the Mongolian steppe, you can't just sort of like get the garbage men to come in, right? And so this is how they deal with it. So this burning thing is actually a fairly recent phenomenon. So again, this is not something we would have seen 15, 20 years ago. And just to emphasize that as we're going out and we're doing these kind of ethno-archaeological approaches, that that's shifting over in the time that we're doing this kind of work as well.
Then we arrived to this winter campsite, and we thought, whoa, look, what fire was in here, right? So it seems like it's a fire affected the winter campsite, but everything was like not affected, only here. So we went and we jumped into this thing. And actually underneath this crust, it was liquid. So this thing, I don't have a detail, but this thing is a crust of nitrates. So what happens when your all animals are peeing there? So everything accumulates in there, and then the chemical process makes a crust that seems like it's charred. But if you take this crust, everything there underneath is orange liquid, which is then pure nitrates there. So also we have to, I put this picture because we have to be careful when we are, oh, look, this is a fire. But if you don't take out the crust and make some analysis, you would think, oh, they made a fire here or something happened here, but actually it's not a fire, even if it looks like. So let's go with more details on fire use. So they usually have these stoves. These are the traditional, and they keep using it. Even they have this metal thing. So they collect the dung and they put it in here. So they have always fuel for have this fire going on. Usually these fires are going on all day long. So they have, they start in the morning doing the yogurt and all the things, all the milk products. They start very early in the morning, so they milk the cattle starting at 5, 6 a.m. So during all day, they are working with these products. So they cook in here, and you can, I don't have a picture of that. I was searching for it, but I didn't find it. The old women, they go through the landscape with these sticks and these baskets, taking the dung and collecting them, and then taking back to the campsite, and then they can cook with it, and they use it for cooking, for heating, for drying. And these are the other type of stoves they're using. So this is the one type, smaller, and then the other, this is very big, and they put the dung fuel inside. So as I said before, they usually don't do open air fires, and when they do, they put the little stuff, they put it outside, and it's always protected. They never go in here, and when they will make a fire. There was that very lucky afternoon that they show us how they take profit of all the gold products, from the skin to the everything. They take profit, and they dry the skin into the walls. As I said, dung is the most precious fuel for them because it's everywhere. But they also, in the forest area, they have this large wood, and the large are here. So they collect them, they let them dry, and they use for fuel for cooking also. But the only, that is the only use, because for, like I said, smudge fires, or even when they have more dung collected, they prefer to use dung. Wood, because wood is very precious and it's very scarce, and they would need it in winter for making the winter campsites. So they don't abuse of this of the wood. So what about the camel dung? They have camels, but the camel dung that you think, why don't use it for fuel also? They don't use it for anything. So they say that no, it's not. It has no power for lighting fire, but actually it has. But I think it's a more traditional, because anyone uses it, for they don't use it. The sons don't use it, so they only use for camels for transport. And I want to point out this very, very, very important thing for also for the archaeologists, and when the archaeologists are working in the landscape and they are excavating, we have to take in account also. Maybe as David said yesterday, the site maintenance, because all these processes, we can detect it in micromorphology, like racking and cleaning the soils. Here are the cattle, when they start the milking, there is a guy that is taking care of all the fresh dung, pile it here, and then they put it to dry outside. We can, if we don't know this process, we just see the feature in the micromorphology, but we don't have the explanation. And that's why ethnography is important, to be there and to see why it's actually happening. And then the other thing is this one. As pastoral society, they don't burn the dung stables, because other societies, they usually burn it to clean, like they say, parasites or diseases. But they don't do it. They just go in summer to the winter campsites, and they break again the soil to let it dry, and then they take these chunks of dung and they collect them, and then they have fuel for passing the winter, and then they even they have can sell it in the zones. So it's a very, they prefer it to the coal, because the coal is very expensive and the dung burns perfectly. So this thing of the breaking the soil, like, is 20 centimeters only. Each season, you can detect it also in macromorphology. So we have to take into account all this human behavior into the the landscape. And you can see here, they made this like in 5 minutes, like two persons, and they were like robots. They have a very perfect technique. And we tried to do this, and I was not able. So it was very, yeah, it was very funny. But you see here, it's like we measure that, and it's, they only remove the first 20 centimeters, so we have this data also for looking in the blocks when they take the blocks. So it's good. I will show you some results later. So we start with some micromorphology blocks, just to see the variation, because this is going can be very long, and this is a burnt deposit. So we also have samples from these trash pits, so we want to see how the fire looks like in these deposits, even if it's not wood fuel, but just to see how it affects the organic matter inside and how affects also the taphonomy of the pyrotechnology here. So, and this is another thing. This is from the north, all this, and you see it's a lot of bioturbation, things that we have to take in account when we have to think where we are taking the samples. We are in the north, we are in the middle of the steppe, we are in the south. This is another variation also in the north with fodder, so we take all these, like I said, all these little features, so we can have a very good view of what is going there and how it looks like in the micro record. So this is in the middle step. So it's very different. You see, it's a lot of layering of these pellets, and they are perfectly intact in there. And this is a thin section of this block. And you see here the breaking of this foil. Sorry. As I said before, is this first layer is all removed, so you see the sharp contact. So something happened here, and it could be related also with this breaking of the soil or this cutting. And then you have this typical stabling features that we find in micromorphology, like you have here the perfect pellets of the ovicaprine animals here, and layering of all the materials inside, phytoliths accumulation, spherulites everywhere, and you have here details of these pictures. This is microcoprolites. You see the whole pellet inside with the vegetal remains. We have this layering of the elements that indicates trampling. Just think about 500 animals trampling into the same floor. And then we have these ummified vegetal remains. We know it's ummified because it's not burned. So if we see this feature in the microscope, like we don't know, we can doubt, is it charred? Is it humified? We have all this, always this doubt. And then the mineral fraction, bioturbation, phytolith layering embedding, stem cells that are very well preserved. And this is a very big concentration of spherulites. And then another time variations. This is the same middle step area, and you see this perfect layering of mineral differences. This is a deposit of clay, gray clay, that is coming from the lakes, and we don't know why is it the top. So we can imagine that they have lakes near, and they want to prepare the soil again for the next season, so they cover with this clay. Or another variation, this is a not perfectly layered floor, but you can even see the pellets here at the surface, and there was hair inside of the soil, etc. And then in the south, this is the kind of landscape that we have, the rocky, and then the transitional part to the rocky is this kind of landscape. So we took samples also from this natural soil, and this is from the stablings also. This is an example. This is a sample, the micromorphology slide from this sample that it was here. So everything in the first centimeter is eroded and removed and broken, but if you see here, you have the pellets also. So everything is again the same features that we saw before. The bedding, the phytoliths, the trampling, then the coprolites, and the pellets here. And then for each sample that we took, for each campsite, we have control samples. We have the natural soil and we have the anthropogenic use of the space, and we have these little features. So we started what we are doing here, that I'm here in the lab working with Carolina, trying to make to detect the lipid signal of these natural soils and these also staling floors. So we started with one control sample. This is a dune soil, so it's supposed to be very low in organics. And we started with trying to do the alkanes. And this is the first result we have. So it shows, as we expected, because it's a dune, and it's in the desert, and it's not near the sea, it's continental. So the signal is a terrestrial plant source. So we expect that to compare the natural soils with these stabling floors to have all the signals and have to see the differences of this. And in the future, we want to try also the deuterium, trying to detect more, like it's water source, or it was more wet ambient, or it was drier, etc. And then when we start to have this, the actual signal of everything, then we can start with the archaeological signals. So we have a reference for looking what was happening in the past, compare what is happening now. And we want to thank especially to all the AmbiLab team, and especially to Marga and Antonio for their patience with me, to teaching me how to do this. And our fieldwork team that went with us in Mongolia, we were only 9 people for almost 2 months. And it was really hard to sample 56 campsites in that time. And especially for all the beautiful Mongolian people, that I want to say thank you.